Well, hey, listen, let's do this. Let's go before the Lord and let's ask His Holy Spirit tonight to speak to each and every one of us right where we're at, because I believe that it's God's word that wants to impart into your life some things, some encouragement, some direction tonight. So let's ask God to speak to us right where we're at as we get into His word tonight. Father, we thank You that we get to come into Your house. Lord, we thank You that we get to come tonight and to hear from You. Lord, we don't take it for granted. We don't come just to fulfill religious traditions or institutional traditions, but Lord, we come into this place to hear from You. Lord, it's not about a man. It's not about the advice or the directions of a man, but Lord, it is about the words of Jesus Christ, Lord, and the direction of Your Holy Spirit. So Father, we ask that Your Spirit, the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, through Your word and in your Bible, Father, would speak to us right where we're at, Lord, words of encouragement, of direction, of clarity in our lives, that we might walk out of this place to serve You, to reflect Your goodness and Your light for the world to see who You are, and that You are a good God who loves humanity, who's done great things for us. And Father, I thank You that we would be Your church, Your vessels of that message to this world. And Lord, we give You the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all together said, amen. If you've got your Bibles, you can go with me to the book of Mark in the 4th chapter. If you can put a ribbon there or put your thumb there, we're going to read that first. And then you can go to Matthew in the 25th chapter. We'll end there today. Mark in the 4th chapter, Matthew in the 25th chapter. So now I don't want to talk to you about all the small things. This is what I'm going to call it, the idea of these small things in life. You know, I was having this really interesting conversation with my mom, Pastor Deborah. Pastor Deborah's gotten into this kind of newfound hobby of flipping furniture. You see all the TV shows and everything that's been going on. I think as my parents are kind of dealing with and coping with this idea of time on their hands in this retired or semi-retired life, she's taken a bunch of different things. She took this really cool church pew and painted it, and she took this old furniture and kind of flipped it and took something that was real old and just dated and made it really neat and modern. And we were kind of talking about it, and her and I were talking about our hobbies of creating things. You know, many of you know that one of the things that I enjoy doing is woodworking, and there's something in me. I just really feel like I'm a highly spiritual person, and I've tried to make all of my hobbies that which my Lord and Savior was also. So carpentry, and Jesus walked a lot, so hiking and things like that. You know, He climbed a mountain once and He was transfigured, and I've always tried to. So woodworking, in the steps of my Savior, woodworking is one of those things that I've chosen. I'm totally being sarcastic. But we were talking about this idea of saving some of the projects that we have for a later time. You know, a couple of years ago, my wife and I found out that her grandfather had felled some trees. Felled is just a classy word to say cut down some trees and converted them into some really neat lumber back in the 60s. And they had been sitting in the shipping container long after he'd passed. And they were just sitting there. And so we reached out to my wife's aunt, and she said, yeah, come and get whatever you want. And so in a sense, I inherited all this really cool and expensive lumber, some walnuts, some cherry, some old growth things. I mean, some just really expensive pieces of wood. And I remember I took them home and I had to buy a commercial grade lumber rack to store all of the wood that I had in my garage kind of slash wood shop. And I was talking to my mom about it, and we were kind of talking about our plans. And this idea came up, this thought came up of, you know, I have all this wood that's been sitting on a wood rack in my garage because I want to do something really good with this wood. I don't want to just do something small. I don't want to just do anything with it. I want to do something really good. And I was telling my mom, I said, like, I don't feel like I'm good enough at what I do to bring honor to this wood. So every time I start a new project and my wife asks me, maybe would you do this or would you do that? Or I want to do something maybe small in my garage or my shop as a small project, I'll go to the lumber yard and I'll buy wood that I already have at home. Because I just feel in my own life that I'm just not good enough yet to use that wood. And so there, for years and years and years, that wood has sat unused and unutilized in my life, just yearning, beckoning every time I park a car in the garage, every time I go in there, to be created or to be molded or fashioned into just something functionable and fashionable in what I can do. I think sometimes it's amazing how we look at insecurities in life and how much insecurity in life has a tendency to hold us back because, like my lumber situation in my garage, because we're just not good enough to do something. We're not good enough to reach out. We're not good enough to do it. So what happens is insecurity comes into our lives and we don't do anything or we don't do what we should otherwise do, and we know it because we just feel inadequate. We feel unqualified. We feel like if I was to do it at this point in my life, it just wouldn't be what I think it would be. It wouldn't happen like I think it would happen. It wouldn't look the way I think it should happen. And so what happens with insecurity is we stop and we don't do anything because it literally holds us back. It binds us. I think to our faith as Christians, to things as simple as talking to somebody, our neighbor, or somebody across the street or at the shopping market or wherever it might be, of talking to somebody that we're connected to in our lives about our faith, about reaching out and serving somebody in the name of Jesus, or getting involved in church or in a ministry, doing something at a greater capacity than just coming and receiving God's word. When I think about our faith, it's amazing how much insecurity creeps into our own walk in faith and how much it stops us from doing that which we know through God's own words what we should do. The tragic fact is that some 90% of Christians don't share their faith with anybody else because when they do, they feel inadequate to talk to your neighbor about what's going on in your life through your faith, to share with somebody that you don't even know, a complete stranger, that Jesus loves them, to serve somebody else in the name of Jesus. Insecurity creeps in our lives and we say, you know what, if I was to talk about it to my neighbor, they might have a question and I don't know the answer to that question. And so I don't want to look like a fool and I don't want to give Christianity a bad name. So I'll just kind of leave that to the pastor. To serving somebody. I may not meet their expectations. I may not do it in which the way they think that I should do it, or it may not go the way in which I plan or the way I think it should go. And so I'm just not going to be good enough at it. And so I don't. And to getting involved in a church, I don't know where to start. I don't know where to begin. There's so many different areas and there's so many different opportunities and there's so many different things that it's kind of like, where do I even begin? I'm kind of in over my head on this. And because of that, I think I'll just kind of come and I'll do it next week. I'll do it next month. I'll do it next year. And time goes on like that lumber in my garage, year after year after year. The insecurities hold us back from doing what we know we should and could be able to do. It's not so surprising when we read our Bible that we have this complex in our lives, because we read these narratives of these great figures. I mean, you think about it like this, the children of Israel, when they spied on the promised land coming from Egypt into this new place, the promised land, they came back and they reported, but there were giants in the land. And sometimes today, insecurity can make us feel the same way about our own scriptural text. That when we look at the lives of men like Moses, men like Noah, who built an ark when nobody else would, men like David, who killed a giant, men like Elijah, who called down fire from heaven, men like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who stood against one of the greatest Middle Eastern powers of this world, men like Jesus, who carried his cross, or Paul the Apostle, who was so eloquent in writing, or James, who was so zealous in speaking. It's no wonder that we sometimes get this complex of, how will I ever measure up? How will I ever be like somebody in the Bible? I want to do something, and I want it to be good, and I want it to be significant, and I want it to do great things for the kingdom of God, because after all, in the words of Jesus himself, he said that we would do greater things than he did. And so then we look at our lives, and insecurity comes in because right now I'm not educated enough. I don't know enough about the gospel. I'm not bold enough. I'm not zealous enough. I'm just human. I make mistakes like everybody else. And I feel like if I was to do something right now, it's not my season. And then it holds us back from doing what God wants us to do and what God has called us to do. To be representatives, to be like my sweater says, I thought I'd represent our missionaries who were going to Nicaragua and going to Mexico, Philippines, Nicaragua, and is it the DR or no? No, it's just Mexico. Yeah, all right. This is our missionary sweater, so I was like, hey guys, I want to represent you. And I want to be the light, like it says out of Matthew, the light of the world. But I'm just not so sure that if I shine today, I'll be bright enough for anybody to see. So I'm just going to wait. You think about it, even in our own society today, we live in the information day and age. We have more information than we know what to do with. We have more information that we at our fingertips than we even understand or that we even really comprehend. We have the ability today to know more than any other generation on earth has ever known at any given time. And on one hand, that's amazing because what could we accomplish with the knowledge that we as humanity have amassed together? But then on the other hand, now because of all that we have access to, we have so much more to compare ourselves to. So-and-so on the other side of the world. So-and-so over here in this church over there and what they're doing. And that congregation over here or my neighbors over here watching them on social media. You know, 15 years ago in church, churchgoers would listen to their pastor, and that was it. Pastor would preach a message. They might go buy a cassette tape. Remember those? Millennials are like, what is that? That's that thing I see at the antique store, right? Yeah, a cassette tape. They might go buy the cassette tape, and if it was a really good, they'd buy that little book. You remember that plastic book that had like 6 cassette tapes because it was a series, or the preacher preached so long that it wouldn't fit on one cassette tape, like right in the climax of the message, you'd have to like take the tape out and flip it over, and you'd miss like 30 seconds of what was ever said, and you're like, no! Whereas now statistics show that the average churchgoer listens to 4 to 5 other pastors other than the one that they listen to on a Sunday or on a Wednesday night. Because you've got podcasts, because we've got television, because we've got satellite TV, because we've got networks like TBN and TBN Salsa, and now the Hillsong Channel, and all the different things that are going on. We have more information today than we know what to do with. And with all of that information, we're blessed in that, but it also creates the trap of insecurity of comparisons. And that now we look around, and because we have more information, we feel less qualified. We feel less adept to doing what God wants for us to do. And we want to do something for God's kingdom, but we just don't even know where to start. But the good news is that in our day and age, 2,000 years after Jesus came, 2,000 years after he died on the cross, after we read the writings of his followers and his closest followers, we have the assurance in our own lives that they felt the same way that we feel today, inadequate, unprepared, unqualified to represent the kingdom of God to this world. But yet we know with the sense of hindsight that they did some amazing things in the name of Jesus. That the words of Jesus Christ, when he said, greater things you will do, his disciples took him literally. And they did greater things. Maybe not greater things in scale, but greater things in number. Why? Because now it's not just one person doing everything, but it's multiple people over and over and over and over and over again. And when we look at the kingdom of God, we say, God, today that's the cry of our hearts, that's the cry of our generations, is to God to do something great, big, and magnificent for your kingdom. But Jesus has a way of taking all of our expectations and kind of flipping them on their head. Everything we thought we knew, Jesus just has this uncanny way of taking everything that we thought we knew, every status quo, every cultural norm, and just taking, you thought it was this. But if somebody slaps you, don't just bare the one cheek, give them the other one. If somebody asks you, go the extra mile with them. And he takes all these things. He says, you've heard it said to love your neighbor and hate your enemy. And Jesus says, well, I'll tell you this, to love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. And everybody who is listening to Jesus is like, this guy is speaking in a different world, in a different way, and in a different fashion than anybody else. Why? Because he's speaking not like scribes who spoke what other men said, but now he's speaking the very words of God to humanity to do something great. In one of Jesus's parables, Jesus makes this amazing comparison today to these disciples who just didn't feel like they would add up. And Jesus was so brilliant in his communication style and the way that he spoke. And Jesus writes this parable in Mark, the fourth chapter, and that's where I had you turn. That I want to just show you this idea that we have. Jesus says in verse number 30 of Mark, the fourth chapter, in a series of parables about the kingdom of God, Jesus kind of gives us this real interesting and unique parable. In verse number 30, Jesus says, to what shall we liken the kingdom of God? What should we compare it to? What should we look at it as an image of, this kingdom that is at hand, that is accessible, that has been available for eternity but inaccessible to humanity? What shall we liken it to? And he says, it's like a mustard seed, which, when it's sown into the ground, is smaller than all the other seeds on earth. But when it is sown, it grows up and becomes greater than all the herbs and shoots out large branches so that the birds of the air might rest under its shade. And Jesus says, in the comparison of life, in the feelings of inadequacy, in the insecurities that you face as you have been invited to participate and to rule and to reign in my kingdom in heaven, now brought to earth, what should I compare it like? And the disciples, they're arguing about who's going to be the greatest, who's going to call down thunder from heaven, who's going to do all these great and magnificent things. And Jesus says, let me give you an image of what it's really like in terms of your insecurity, in terms of your ability, in terms of the fact, how are you ever going to measure up to the expectations of God's kingdom? And Jesus says, I'm going to compare it to a mustard seed. Now, I went to Home Depot as I drove here this evening and spent $1.59 on this illustration. I really went super hard on this one. And I bought a mustard seed packet. Now, mustard seeds are pretty small. As a matter of fact, you're not even going to see it because we have standard definition cameras. Our video department's like, amen, praise Jesus. HD someday. See, you can't see it. But that's a mustard seed. And that's Jesus' point. That the kingdom of heaven is like this. There's actually something on the tip of my finger right now. It's a mustard seed. He says, it's really small. It's really insignificant. There's not much to it. It doesn't look anything glamorous. It doesn't look like anything amazing. But he says, when you plant it into the ground, something begins to happen to that mustard seed. And it grows. And it doesn't stay an insignificant little tiny seed that doesn't do anything, but rather it becomes something great, something bigger than everything else, to the sense that the birds even can land on its branches and nestle, and people can sit and enjoy the shade that that tiny little seed provides to you and I. And so often what happens in our lives is that Jesus says to us, he takes our expectations, he takes our idea that, God, I want to do something. God, I want to make a difference in this world. I want to matter. I want to live a life that means something on earth today. And because of that, there's something I need to do, but I don't even know what it is. And because I don't know what it is, and I don't feel like I'm good enough, I don't feel like I have anything I can do. And Jesus says this. It's not about the big things in life. So often what happens is we get so focused on leaving an impact, about doing something big for the kingdom of God. God, I just want somebody to remember me. I want somebody to come to my funeral. I want somebody to do something that I would leave an impact on somebody's life, because I want to do great things. I want to do greater things. I want to do big things. And like that lumber yard or lumber rack in my garage, we say that there's something greater ahead of me, but I'm not qualified. I can't attain it. I can't achieve it. Insecurity settles in because I'm not good enough for it. And Jesus says, look, it's not about focusing on the big picture and the big things and the big impact on life. Jesus says, if you want to know what my kingdom is that I'm inviting you to participate and to be a part of in life, he says, if you want to know what it is, he says, it's like a tiny, insignificant little seed that you can barely even see. It's so small. And what I get out of this is Jesus is encouraging his disciples to eventually go and change the face of this earth to the point in which most people on earth have heard of the name of Jesus Christ. That he has transformed a symbol, an image of torture and of shame, into the most recognized symbol on earth, a symbol of love, the cross. That these people that Jesus was speaking to, who were inadequate and insufficient and never measured up, that didn't do great big things in life, they weren't the best of the best in the best of their class, they weren't the highest and the most educated people. Jesus says the kingdom of heaven, you, your life, and what you do is a lot like this little mustard seed. Fell off my finger. Can't even hold it. It's so small. It's so minuscule. It's so insignificant that as you look for the big impact in life, you might overlook what God wants to do today. And so what we do is we look for the big picture. We look for the big things. We look for the big impact. But I believe what Jesus was telling his disciples as they were wondering, how are we ever going to measure up to you? How are we ever going to do the things that you do? How are we going to ever speak with the authority that you speak with? How are we ever going to represent this kingdom like you represent? Because we're just fishermen. We're just tax collectors. We're just zealots that wanted to see the Roman Empire overthrown. We're just average Joes. And Jesus says the kingdom of heaven isn't of the educated. It isn't of the great. Isn't it of the big things? The kingdom of heaven is like a little mustard seed. Little things. And I believe Jesus was telling his disciple this. That God, he likes to take the little things in life and make big things out of them. I mean, you think about it. He did that with us, with humanity. You see, he spoke the stars into existence. He placed the sun and the moon in its place. He separated the land and the water. He spoke creation, zebras and giraffes and camels. What was he thinking with camels? I can't figure that one out. You ever seen a camel? God was like in a funny mood right there. He's like, all right, I've had too many serious animals. I'm gonna make a camel. He spoke these things into existence. And then it came time for his manifesto, the greatest creation of all, the biggest miracle of everything. Not the miracle of the universe, not the miracle of earth, not the miracle of oxygen and nitrogen ratios in the air, not the miracle of the oceans, not the miracle of the mountains, the miracle of humanity. That he gave humanity dominion over all of his creation. And how did he create humanity in which he spoke everything into existence? He has a way of taking little things insignificant things, worthless things, and making big things out of them. You see, God spoke everything into existence, but with you and with me, He gathered the dust of the earth, the insignificant waste of the earth, and He formed it, and He fashioned it, and then He breathed His life into that dust. And God has a way of making little things big things. God has a way, a couple of weeks ago I talked about it, of taking little things and making big things out of them. He took a little kid by the name of David and a rock, and He took the rock and He made the rock beat a professional warrior. He took an uneducated man like Noah, who had no construction experience at all, and he just had a way of giving this guy a couple of 100 years. You think your home improvement projects are long? To build an ark. How about this one? There was a little boy one day when Jesus was preaching that brought a sack lunch to the message. Nobody else brought anything to eat. And Jesus took the boy's fish and his loaves, his bread. And He has a way of taking little things and making big things out of them. But you see, we want a big impact. We want to last. We want a lasting legacy. We want a reason for existence. We have grandiose ideas to do something for the kingdom of God. And so what happens is we see the big things, and we see the people across the way, and we see the preacher, how he preaches, and his veins pop out of his neck, and we say, I can't talk to my neighbors because I'm not prepared enough to talk to my neighbors. I'm not equipped enough. I didn't go to seminary. I didn't read my Bible today. I don't even know enough. But God has a way of taking little things and making big things out of them. But the problem is our complex of insecurity. Because we live in a culture that is captivated by extraordinary. When we go to the movies, we pay money to go to movies to watch people retell the stories of extraordinary people doing extraordinary things. We look at celebrities and they do extraordinary things. Their new albums and the amount of fans that they have. We look at athletes and how extraordinary they are. Amazing human beings that as a culture, as a society, we have become accustomed to acknowledging and celebrating the extraordinary to the point where as a culture, we worship it. And then to add to that, now a generation, 78 million strong, is entering this world into adulthood. They were told growing up that they were special and they were unique and that they could do anything they wanted to if they just put their mind to it. And we celebrate the extraordinary and we look at the big things. We look at the world changers. We look at the preachers on the pulpit and the people behind the podiums who are giving the speeches that change the world. And we say, I gotta get to be like that to do anything of significance. And Jesus says, it's not about how big you are. It's about the little things in life. But we don't celebrate those. We don't congratulate those. I mean, think about it like this. Would you spend your money, your hard-earned money, would you spend your money going to a six-hour saga at the movies about a secretary who works in a high-rise who lives a normal life? About a dad who does everything he can to put food on the table for his kids and read his kids a story before they go to bed. About a mom who folds laundry all day long until her kids are grown up and gone. Nobody would pay money to go to a movie to see somebody's average, little, insignificant mustard seed life. Because we've been trained culturally. Society has shown us that We don't celebrate these things. But Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven is about the small things. And that God has a way of taking small things in our lives and making them big things in the kingdom of God. And maybe, just maybe, we've been as a follower group of people, people who are following Jesus. Maybe, just maybe, we have been trying to measure God's desire for our lives with our culture's standards. That God wants me to do something big. That God wants me to accomplish something massive. That the pressure is so great on me that I don't even know what to do. That I don't know what to say. I don't know how to say it. How am I ever going to live up to what God wants me to do for his kingdom? Because our culture's standards is bigger, is better. You see the McDonald's billboard? There's not even a Big Mac anymore. There's like a bigger Mac. And now we measure what God wants for us by our culture's standards. That God wants something for you and it's big and it's massive and it's great. And now there's this pressure, there's this burden, there's this sense of complex that comes on us of insecurity saying, I just don't feel good enough to accomplish what God wants to do in me. I don't feel smart enough to share my faith. I don't feel qualified enough to represent the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so we, as a church, as the followers of Jesus Christ, have sat down when we should be standing up, have backed off when we should be pressing on, because insecurities, insufficiencies, and doubts and complexes of not adding up and not measuring up to the great expectations that we've put upon ourselves. When simply put, Jesus says, the kingdom of heaven is about the little things in life. The little things in life. See, nobody would celebrate the average life. Nobody would celebrate somebody who's just going to work every day for 25 years to work their job, to be the best they can, to retire and to live a life. That's just what we do. That's just general expectations. But maybe if we would just take a moment in our own lives, take a big deep breath and stop trying to measure God's desire, God's plans, and God's expectations on us with our culture standards. And we look at what Jesus said. Look at the mustard seeds in our lives. What is the mustard seed in your life? I see my friend. I didn't tell him I was going to tell him. I won't use his name. But I see my friend and I had a conversation with him. A couple of weeks ago, we were just talking about life, and I've always admired my friend. And he's worked in a place that most God-fearing Christians wouldn't, or at least shouldn't, step into. And it's not a strip club or anything like that, so don't think like that, all right? He's like, hey, don't make me out to be worse than I am, okay? Come on. And we were talking about it. I've always admired him. Because most people in life would say, I got to get out of this place. I got to make a change. I got to stop doing what I'm doing. I got to stop being around the people that I'm at. I'm tired of being around Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm tired of being around the conditions of the world. I want something bigger and I want something greater in my life. And as we were sitting over coffee, I just told him, I said, dude, somebody needs to celebrate you because you're doing what Jesus said to do. You see, you're going where most Christians won't even go. And you go every day, 5 days a week, you show up and you're consistent and you smile to people that most Christians won't even smile at. And you talk to people who in the course of most of their lives won't even set foot in a church because of what they're going through and what they're living through. And yet you are there every day for the past 20 years representing Jesus Christ. And yes, you may not be an evangelist on TV. And no, you may not be standing on a pulpit preaching to everybody the gospel of Jesus Christ. But I said, you're fulfilling the commission in which Jesus sent us out to do, to go into the world. And I told him, I said, bro, you're like their pastor, because they may never come and know me, but they know you. And when something happens in their life, they come to you for prayer. When something happens in their life, they come to you for advice. And you see, we look at the big things and we say, God, I want big things. And God just says, how about you just deal with the mustard seed of your life? And not let me worry, and not worry about the big expectations that'll happen. So I think if we would just take a breath as the church and not worry about how qualified, how educated, how Christian we look, and we would just think about the mustard seeds in our lives, that God says, I have a tendency, it's a hobby of mine, to take the little insignificant things that you think don't measure or don't add up. And I love it when I get to take some little things and I get to make big things out of them. If we would just, as the church, learn to look at our mustard seeds in life. And I think that if there's anything that I say as you walk out of here tonight looking at what Jesus is saying about the kingdom of heaven, is that what if God wants to take that mustard seed that you've been overlooking because you're thinking about the bigger thing? And what if God wants to take that mustard seed, that little thing, that insignificant thing, the fact that you're working and you're at the end of your rope because you've been waiting for your big break and it's not coming and you're about ready to give up? The fact that you want to be a better parent, but time just keeps taking you away. The fact that you want to go deeper in your relationship with God, but it's like, where am I going to figure out how to do that? If God would just says this, if you would just take a moment to not worry about the big things, but just to look at the mustard seed that you have in your hand that's so small and so insignificant that you've probably spent the course of your life overlooking it, and you would just cultivate the mustard seed in front of you today. God has a tendency to make the little things become big things in our lives. And you see, we want that big break. God says, cultivate the mustard seed of your job. Keep showing up. Do everything you do unto the Lord. Be a representation of Jesus Christ. Don't fit into what everybody else is doing around you. Cultivate the mustard seed. Just work like a Christian should work. And if Christians would cultivate that mustard seed, we wouldn't have the rap of not doing business with other Christians. You want to be a better parent? Cultivate that mustard seed. Start saying no to things in life today so that you can cultivate that small, insignificant 20 minutes it might take to spend time with your child. You want to go deeper in your relationship with God? Cultivate the mustard seed today, because that seed's not going to grow if you don't put it in the ground. See, Jesus didn't just say that the kingdom of heaven's like a mustard seed. Cool, I got a mustard seed. I'll put it in a plastic container and put it on a chain around my neck. And every time I look at my life, I'll think about all the small things. Yes, that's a Blink-182 song, but I won't think about that. Jesus says, no, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that you cultivate, that you stop staring at it or overlooking at it, but put it in the ground and water it and do something with it and watch that little, tiny, insignificant thing that you don't even worry about because it's so small in your life to become something so big in your life. Maybe there's that person that you know you've needed to talk to, but you're worried that you don't know what to say. You're worried that you don't know what to do. Cultivate that mustard seed that you're looking at. Put it in the ground. Stop worrying about what you'd say. Stop worrying about coming up with the right answers. Maybe, just maybe, somebody will ask you a question that you don't know the answer to. You know what a good, godly Christian answer is? I don't know. But we spend so much time wanting to make an impact, wanting to be somebody, wanting to do something, that we overlook the mustard seeds God has put into our lives. See, Jesus tells his disciples in Matthew, the 25th chapter. He tells a story. He says there's going to be a time when the king is going to gather everybody together. And he's going to take goats and sheep. Okay. He's going to put the goats on one side. He's going to put the sheep on the other side as a representation. My dad always said it like this. Goats are like rams. They always go butt. They're always questioning, always talking, always arguing. Sheep, they just kind of follow the shepherd. So Jesus says, I'm going to take the goats and I'm going to take the sheep. And he says to the sheep, says in Matthew, the 25th chapter, actually, I want you to go there because I want to read the words of Jesus, not just say the words of Jesus. Matthew, the 25th chapter. Jesus says it like this in verse number 34. My notes said 24, and I'm like, dang, that's a lot of scriptures. Verse number 34, Jesus says it like this. He says, the king will come and say to those on his right, that's the sheep, come, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you took me in. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. And I could just imagine right now, as he's saying this, his disciples are saying, what are you talking about, Jesus? Never in my life have I seen you naked. Never in my life have I seen you in prison yet. Never in my life have I seen you starving. As a matter of fact, twice, Jesus, I've seen you turn nothing into something. And Jesus says these words. His disciples will come and say, when did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will say, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch, look at this, as you did it to the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me. You see, we want to do something big. We all want to matter. We all want to make a difference. We all want to have an impact. We want to make a splash on our world. So we look and we say, I want to do something big for the kingdom of God. And Jesus comes back and he turns the idea on its head. And he says, when you've done that to the least of these, my brethren, it's as if you did it straight to me. See, when you cultivate that mustard seed, Jesus says it's as if you did it straight to me. When you share your faith, even though you don't know what to say, it's as if you shared your faith with me. When you go out of your way to serve somebody, even though you don't know what to do and you feel stupid, it says it's as if you did it straight to me. When you get involved in the kingdom of God and not just be a spectator in my kingdom and stop letting insecurity hold you back and just do something for me, it's like you did it straight for me. God has a way of taking little things and making big things out of them. I was just having a conversation with Lori. I told her on Sunday, we were talking. She's looking at me all mean. She's like, don't say it. Lori Gamp is her name. She's sitting on the front row. She's a Steelers fan and an Italian. And she's a cook of cooks. She blesses me. And Lori and I have had some great conversations. And Lori was telling me, as she was being open and honest, she was saying, Pastor, I don't feel like I'm doing much in my life right now. Discouraged. Until somebody came and said, Lori, you're blessing me. You're blessing me. You see, sometimes we think it's got to be something big, like preaching on the streets or converting thousands of people to Jesus Christ. But you know, Jesus gave us a great commandment. He said, just go love God. Love your neighbor. I happen to believe that means your actual neighbor, not your metaphorical neighbor. Go and love God. Love your neighbor. And everything else gets taken care of if you just do that. Actually, God, I don't even know how to start. I don't even know what to do with big things in my life. Jesus says in Matthew, the 6th chapter, he says, you can't add an inch to your height by worrying about your life. He says, but if you just seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, everything else will come into place. I believe that we, the church, have allowed insecurity to stop us from doing and being who and what Jesus Christ called us to be. Because we look at the monumental words of Jesus Christ that say, greater things you will do. And we say, I'm just a kid from Ukaipa. What is that going to do for this world? But Jesus says, seek me. There's mustard seeds in your life. Just focus on the mustard seed. Love God. Plant the mustard seed in your life. And let me sweat the big things. Because God has a way of taking the little things and making big things out of them. I think of it like this. A couple of years ago when we started Freedom for Our Future, my wife and I had about $60,000 of consumer debt between credit cards, a mattress payment, yes, a mattress payment, car payments. We wanted to get out of that. We were tired of the pressures of credit card bills coming in every month. And as we look at that, I think it's a lot like society's expectations, because we looked at the biggest payments and we said, we got to get these ones out of the way. So we tried to tackle the biggest payments we could, but you know what? It didn't do anything because we could never add up. So what did we do? We started in the mustard seed. We started on that little tiny payment. It was the mattress that we hated. And we started with the mustard seed. And we paid it off. And then we went to the next one, slightly bigger. The mustard seed started to grow. And we paid it off. And we went to the slightly bigger one. And we started, and the mustard seed grew even bigger. And we paid it off. And through the course of trusting in God, following God's financial advice through his words, we let that mustard seed grow and cultivate into the ground. And eventually, it broke out of that ground and became something big in our lives. That we were able to give more than we ever thought we'd be able to give. That we were able to be more generous with our friends, with our family, with people around us that were in need than we ever thought we'd ever be able to be. And you see, we wanted to make an impact. But instead of focusing on how could I make an impact when I'm drowning under the pressures of life, we focused on the mustard seed of our lives. And through following God's plans, God's directions, and God's ways, that mustard seed grew into something great. Why? Because God has a way of taking the little things in life and making big things out of them. If you're frustrated at your job, cultivate that mustard seed. Start planting that mustard seed. Why? Because God has put you in a position to be an example and a shining light to somebody right around you. If you don't know the people in your community, on your neighborhood, if you don't know the person who lives next door to you or above you or below you in your apartment complex, start somewhere with the mustard seed. I told our young adults ministry a couple weeks ago, start by introducing yourself. Who'd have thunk it? I don't know what to say to my neighbor. You can start by saying, hi, my name is. There's another song from the 90s. Start somewhere, a mustard seed. Because God has a way of taking little things and making big things out of them. And you know what? We all want revival. We all want a move of God. We all want to see things like a great awakening sweep across our nation. But those move of God's, they started with mustard seeds. They started with somebody somewhere praying and believing that God would do something and that God would speak to someone and send someone. And many of those people who prayed in things like great awakenings and revivals, never even lived to see the results of those revivals. But still, God took that mustard seed that they put in the ground, that they cultivated, that they planted, and he grew something big out of it. Your life, hey, it may not be massive. You may not ever stand in front of thousands of people, and some of you who fear public speaking are saying, thank God for that. But God wants to take the mustard seeds that you're looking at right now and make something big out of them. But the question is, will you cultivate that mustard seed in your life, whatever it is, in whatever area it is? Stop worrying about the pressures of being something great and significant, and let God take the little things of our lives and make something great out of them. Because ultimately, as long as we pass and nobody knows our name, if we cultivate that mustard seed, God knows who you are. And it doesn't matter if 1,000 people on earth remember your name, if the creator of the universe says, hey, I took something little in your life and made it something big. That is an impact worth making in our world. Start cultivating that mustard seed that you're looking at in your life, whatever it might be, because God likes to take the little things of our life and make big things out of them. Father, we thank you for your word. I pray that it be an encouragement as we depart this place, Lord, as we look at our lives, maybe, Father, that we'd step out of that comfort zone, that those areas of insecurity that have been holding us back because we just didn't feel like we'd ever measure up, that we would stop holding ourselves to the standards of our society and our culture, and that we would look to you and say, you know what? I've got a mustard seed, and that's all I've got right now, and I'm going to do something with it and let you take the little things of our lives and make something big out of them. I pray that you would encourage us and equip us to be lights of your gospel in Jesus' mighty name. And we all together said, amen. Before we depart tonight, there was a small number of visitors on this cold and dreary night. But I want to take a moment to give you the opportunity to do something that might change the course of your existence here on earth today, all the way through eternity. And that's simply to give you a moment to ask yourself the most important question you can ask yourself. And that question is thus, am I where I need to be with God? You see, I believe with all of my heart, I believe with all of my soul, that as Jesus Christ said, and as the Word of God says, and as Paul the Apostle says, that no one comes to the Father unless the Spirit of God draws him. I believe that God draws us, and it's his desire for us to know him intimately and deeply here today on earth, not just so much what happens when we die. We can ask ourselves, will I go to heaven or will I go to hell? And eternity is the all-important question. But it's not even so much what happens when you die that God is interested in, because God is interested on your life today, the mustard seed that you are holding on to right here, right now. So often we think that we're good with God and everything's right and dandy between us and God because we attend church, because we have a sense of spirituality. I've talked to so many people that say, well, you know, I'm a spiritual person. I believe that there's a God and there's a being out there that's greater than I, and there are forces at work that are greater than myself, and you know, we'll all get to that same place, however it might be. If we have this sense of religion, well, I attend church on a regular, somewhat regular basis. I was baptized a Christian. We have this sense of deeds and of actions that as long as I'm a good person, that God sees that and acknowledges that, and that makes him happy. But can I tell you something? Jesus speaks with the authority of the words of God, and Jesus says that it's not about what you do on the outside. It's not about your sense of spirituality. It's not about your religious traditions of men. It's not about your church attendance. It's not about the mindset that you have in the sense that you hope everything's good between you and God. Jesus says it like this. He says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. He says no one goes to the Father except through him. It's not about our religion. It's not about our deeds. It's not about our thoughts. It's not about our actions. It's not about the fact that you might volunteer in a church or that you might have a card in your wallet that says you're a member. Jesus says the only way in which you are right and where you need to be with me today is through Jesus. A personal relationship with God the Father through his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. There's no other way. It's not about a higher sense of thinking or a sense of spirituality. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is speaking to a man in John, the third chapter. He's having a conversation with a man by the name of Nicodemus, and Jesus says these words to Nicodemus. He says, Nicodemus, in order to inherit eternal life, the kingdom of God, he says, you must be born again. Think about that for a moment. What is an inheritance? When somebody dies on the other side of the earth that you don't know, you don't get anything that they had. Because an inheritance belongs to somebody who's on the inner circle of that person's life. And Jesus says eternity, a life spent with him, a life of fulfillment and existence here on earth today, of creating big things out of the little things in our life. Jesus says the only way in which you and I are brought into that is through him, to be born again. Born again is not what Hollywood and society has made it out to be, you know, weirdo, crazy, out of control Christianity. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word is this. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his only begotten Son, Jesus. It's not about your mental assent or your carnal knowledge of who Jesus is. You could have all the Bible knowledge that you can have here on earth and miss a relationship with God that's meaningful and fulfilling today. Jesus says to the church in the Revelation, he says, I know you. He says, when I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement out of the mouth of Jesus. And what he's saying is that I'd rather find you all the way in, all the way out, not halfway, somewhere in between, deceived in thinking that you're going to make it. Listen, I love you enough. I respect you enough to tell you the truth today. You can't make it with a token prayer. You can't make it with a casual church attendance or a cross around your neck. You can't make it with a sense of religion or spirituality. The only way you can make it is a personal relationship with Jesus Christ every day of your life. And I believe that right now, the Spirit of God is knocking on the door of your heart, inviting you to a relationship with his Son, Jesus, a relationship of life, a relationship of meaning, a relationship of fulfillment. You see, in that very same scripture and that very same statement that Jesus is rebuking the church, he says, I stand at the door and I knock. He says, if you just open the door, I'd come in and we'd have communion, relationship together, and I'd be with you and you'd be with me. How is it that God, the creator of the universe, desires a personal relationship with you? That you would know him and that he would know you intimately all the days of your life. I believe tonight that there's an invitation right now on your heart, that the Spirit of God is knocking on your heart. As you ask yourself honestly that question, the Apostle Paul says to the church at Corinth, he says, listen, there are those of you that you're dealing with sicknesses, you're dealing with weaknesses, you're dealing with issues that you would not need to deal with if you would just take the moment to examine your heart and to examine your life. Today, I ask you to do exactly what Paul says to the church to do. Examine your heart, examine your life. Are you at where you need to be with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ? And if you're not, are you willing to accept tonight the invitation of salvation and life through Jesus Christ? Because Jesus said these words, I have come, he said, that you would have life and that you would have it abundantly, not just eternally, but abundantly on earth. Today, would you receive the invitation? Would you accept the invitation of the Holy Spirit in your life? To life in Jesus Christ through a relationship with him. In just a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity to receive that invitation. And I want to pray a prayer of salvation together with you. Just a moment, I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to do something bold, to get out of your seat, to come and to join me here as I pray. And I want to shake your hand and I want to pray a prayer of salvation, of a destiny change, of a directional change in your life, that you were headed in one direction, but you said, you know what? I feel God is calling me. I feel God is speaking to me, and I feel like it's time to respond today. If that's you, I want to give you that invitation. Just a moment, we'll all stand to our feet, and as we do, my friend Elijah is going to sing a song, and as he sings a song, I want to ask you, would you do this? If the Spirit of God's speaking to you tonight, would you grab your purse? Would you grab your friend? Would you grab your spouse or whoever you came with, your jacket, your umbrella, your Bible? And would you get out of your seat and get out of your chair? Would you come and meet me here so that we can pray a prayer of salvation together? Who should come? If you've never given your heart, give your heart to Jesus. If you're not sure today, don't leave without making sure today. If you've been living a life lukewarm, a life of religion, separated from a distant God, God says, that's not my desire for you today. Would you receive a life of fulfillment through Jesus Christ by making a commitment to follow Him with all of your heart and with all of your life? If that's you, if the Spirit of God's calling you and inviting you to life through Jesus, would you respond and join me in a prayer today? So if that's you in this place, let's all stand together. And as we stand, if that's you, if the Spirit of God's calling you, beckoning you, inviting you, would you respond today by coming and let's pray a prayer of salvation together? Let's change destinies together wherever you're at. If that's you in this place, would you come and respond to God's invitation in your life today?
So come to the altar, the Father's arms are open.
If that's you, you come. If God's calling you, beckoning you, inviting you, would you respond to His invitation to life today? If that's you, come on. Let's change destinies right now. Let's change destinies together today.
His arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with.
Well, praise God. You guys came. And I just want to tell you, listen, you might have a life full of bad decisions. But let me be today, if maybe just today, maybe forever, I don't know. Let me be the first person today to tell you, good job. Good job. You know why I say that? Because it's not about what you've done. It's about what you're doing. You know, you're making the smartest decision you could possibly make today as a human being. To know God, the creator of the universe, to receive life through Jesus. I mean, that says you're smart. That says that you're qualified. That says that you have what it takes to get through this life because you have responded to God's invitation. It's not about me. It's not about Elijah's song. It was about God calling you. And today, here's what we're going to do. We're going to respond to that invitation through a prayer. I'm going to lead you in some words, and I'm going to invite you to join with me, and I'm going to give you some words to say. You say them, but listen, you got to understand this. God's not interested in abracadabra magical formulas. He's not interested in some formula that you repeat and everything's good. He listens to not the words of your mouth, but the prayers of your heart. So I'm going to give you some words to say, but I want them to be your words. I want them to come from your heart as you repeat them after me. And God will hear those prayers. And God's going to respond in your life and change everything in your life. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. So let's pray a prayer of salvation together. As a matter of fact, I'm going to invite everybody to pray in this place tonight. And if you're at home still on the live stream watching, you're welcome to join in with us. And let's pray a prayer tonight of salvation together. Let's all bow our heads. Especially you guys up here, repeat these words after me. Father God, I come today and I thank you that you've invited me, that you've beckoned me, that you called me to follow you. I felt you. And today I respond with my heart, with my life, to make a commitment to follow Jesus as my Lord and as my Savior for the rest of my life. I ask that you'd forgive me of my sins and my past. And I ask that you would give me your future for me. Today, I'm headed for heaven, leaving hell behind. Fill me with your Spirit. Fill me with your words. Speak to me your desire over me. Today, I give my life to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Good job. You did it. Really quickly, I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? It's my honest, I don't want to put expectations on him, but it's my honest opinion that this is the coolest guy I know. There's some cool people, but literally, he's the coolest just because of that jacket, if anything else. No, Pastor Joel is a great guy. Here's what he wants to do. He wants to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on, I promise. He wants to give you some information to point you in the right direction for this journey that you are taking with us. We're going on it together. You're headed on a journey with Jesus, and he wants to point you in the right direction by giving you some information. He's going to connect you with somebody that's going to just talk with you for a moment, pray with you if you need some prayer, and invite you to come back and hang out with us and get connected here at the church to get you connected with somebody that will teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you walked away from today, but you go forward in what God has for you. So if you just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend, Pastor Joel.